Welcome to our worship.
Our opening prayer this morning is by Ted Loader, and it's from page 85 of the book, Gorillas of Grace. Let us join together. O God, your gracious spirit moves over the mysteries of living and dying, and is strangely present to me in the falling leaves, the call of the wild geese, a child's birth, the light in a friend's eyes, the sudden lifting of the heart, and the deep longing which brings me to you now. Make me aware of your presence, that wonder may have its way with me, my passion be released, my confidence renewed in the depths of your holiness, until, for a moment, my longing for you be fulfilled, and I know I am really free to share bread and intimacy, to laugh and exchange mercy, to be at ease in my struggles, bold in my loving, brave in facing down my terror, hopeful in the rising music of your kingdom, joyful in my living, and graceful in my life, becoming a song of praise ever sung to you. Amen. Our first scripture this morning is from the Old Testament book of Proverbs, chapter 8, verses 1 through 4, then 22 through 36. Does not wisdom call, and does not understanding raise her voice? On the heights beside the way, at the crossroads, she takes her stand. Beside the gates in front of the town, at the entrance of the portals, she cries out, "To you, O people, I call, and my cry is to all that live. The Lord created me at the beginning of his work, the first of his acts of long ago. Ages ago, I was set up at the first, before the beginning of the earth. When there were no depths, I was brought forth, when there were no springs abounding with water. Before the mountains had been shaped, before the hills, I was brought forth. When he had not yet made earth and fields, or the world's first bits of soil. When he established the heavens, I was there. When he drew a circle on the face of the deep. When he made firm the skies above. When he established the fountains of the deep. When he assigned to the sea its limit, so that the waters might not transgress his command. When he marked out the foundations of the earth. When I was beside him, like a master worker, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing before him always, rejoicing in his inhabited world and delighting in the human race. And now, my children, listen to me. Happy are those who keep my ways. Hear instructions and be wise, and do not neglect it. Happy is the one who listens to me, watching daily at my gates, waiting beside my doors. For whoever finds me finds life and obtains favor from the Lord. But those who miss me injure themselves, and who hate me, all who hate me, love death." And then from the New Testament, a book of Romans, chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. "Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us." And then from the book of John, chapter 16, verses 12 through 15. "I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. May the Lord add his blessings to this, the reading of his word today.
I invite you to be in prayer with me. Wonderful God, I pray that you might be with us as we reflect together on your word. May the words of my mouth and meditation of our hearts be an offering to you, the Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So, I do have a cartoon for you this morning. Hamlet, Hagar is talking to his son Hamlet. Hamlet, as you grow older, always try to look for the best in people, even if you have to use a magnifying glass. As you might have noticed, I like cartoons. And this one is on my wall in my home office, above my desk. And I think of it as a little bit of humorous wisdom. Is it true that as we grow older, we gain wisdom? Could part of growing older mean a call to share wisdom, even to pass it down to a younger generation, as Hagar does in the cartoon? As I grow older, and from many years of ministry with older adults, I think the answer is, of course, yes and no. I hate to say it, but I have seen people in their 80s act like they were in junior high. You know, petty backbiting and saying petty rivalries. And I have seen five-year-olds have a great, say something very wise. So no, the call of wisdom does not depend upon age. Yet I do think that we, as we grow older, we do have a wider life experience that can help us to have wisdom. I remember working with a young woman in Canyonville who had many problems, many things going on in her life that were bugging her and a problem for her. But one of her biggest problems was that she wanted to take care of everything right now. She had not yet learned the wisdom of age that says, you know what, some things take a little longer and some things are going to change over time. You don't have to do it all right this minute. I had a friend in her 90s in Canyonville who had a bit of wisdom because of her longer perspective. She realized her physical limitations when she was in her 90s. And she told me, I've decided to get up every day and decide one thing I'm going to accomplish that day. And then when I get that one thing done, I feel good. Instead of the multitude, 10 to 12 things a lot of us tried to do. Now, of course, my young friend would have thought my old friend's approach was, bonkers, or at least not for her. So the book of Proverbs was ancient Israel's attempt to gather together the wisdom from the elders and pass it down to the younger generation. Specifically in this book, the young men. I'd be curious of what the book would be if it was to the young ladies of Israel. But we don't have that book. Even so, of course, a lot throughout the book, the young men are warned to be careful of and stay away from the tempting loose woman or the strange woman. But it also lauds the good and faithful wife. And it depicts wisdom itself as a woman. Now, this is not just an image of a wise woman, you know, an older lady. This is wisdom herself, who was with God from the very beginning. Thus, wisdom is shown to be a female energy which stands at the gates of the town and cries out in 8:4, "To you, O people, I call, and my cry is to all that live." And then says in 8:30-31, "I was daily God's delight, rejoicing before God always, rejoicing in the inhabited world and delighting in the human race." So what does it mean to respond to this call of wisdom or Lady Wisdom in our lives? First of all, wisdom's call comes in the city square. I hadn't noticed this before. This time I was reading through the passages in Proverbs about Lady Wisdom. She is active in the places where Israel makes its public decisions, the gate of the city where the elders gather to do justice and decide things for the community, in the market where the people decide and deal with their economic reality. Wisdom calls out in these public places, "Listen to me." I think that this is important because wisdom is a woman, and many ancient cultures wanted to keep women out of the public squares. But wisdom in Proverbs is not telling women to stay home out of sight. She's out there at the city gate, at the city hall of today, calling on people to listen to her, to pay attention to knowledge and wisdom, not just the latest opinion from a media personality or the powerful. Now, believe it or not, I have not often found myself getting involved in public life in previous parishes. Of course, preaching most Sundays is a public act. Anybody can come in and listen. Although, as you can see, there's not that great a number listening to my preaching. And preachers in general have less influence than they used to, even on TV. But since coming to Springfield, it has been my privilege to attend some school board meetings and city council meetings. What I found is that even if we don't say much, our presence at those meetings matters. After a while, those publicly elected officials notice who cares about what they do and don't do. Maybe you think you don't have wisdom to bring to the public square, but Lady Wisdom is calling out to us. Could it be that your experience of life, of faith, of struggle and recovery, your longer view of things could benefit our city and our school board? Is Lady Wisdom inviting you to come to her and speak up with her? Secondly, I think wisdom's call means to pay attention to our priorities. Later on, after the passage we read today, Lady Wisdom says to the people, "Take my instruction instead of silver, and knowledge rather than choice gold. For wisdom is better than jewels, and all that you may desire cannot compare with her. I, Wisdom, live with prudence, and I attain knowledge and discretion." Wisdom's call is to us to keep finding knowledge and truth and wisdom as priorities in our lives. For example, our intentions might be good. We may want to do the loving, kind thing in a situation. But if we do not understand what is happening, if we do not have knowledge of the situation or the people involved or the culture, if we don't pause to ask God for wisdom, we will be more likely to do harm and at the least be ineffective. I tell the famous story, you've all heard the story, I'm just repeating a story you've heard, about the folks that sent sweaters to the Philippines. The Philippines doesn't need sweaters. It is very, very warm all the time in the Philippines. So that was a stupid thing to do, wasn't it? They didn't pay attention to what the needs of the people in the Philippines were. They just sent off their sweaters. Of course, the Filipinos were smart and they unraveled the sweaters and turned them into other things, but you know. I think it's a hard lesson that sometimes we do harm when we intend good. But most of us have had that experience in some way or another. It could be as simple as irritating a grandchild by giving advice they have heard 100 times. Anybody done that? Or as dangerous as sending someone back into a situation that we didn't ask about the potential danger. I think that if we are willing, God will give us the wisdom and knowledge that we need to love and serve well. Yet this means that we have to be willing to learn, to listen and discover that knowledge and wisdom. If we make it a priority, rather than seeking after material things, Lady Wisdom promises our lives will be better. Third, Lady Wisdom's call involves delight. The final part of this passage in Proverbs today emphasizes how Lady Wisdom was with God from the beginning of creation and took part in that great work. In other words, God made creation, the world, with wisdom and delight. What a great thing to realize that following the call of wisdom in our lives can mean to join wisdom in the delight of creation and even humankind. In some passages in Proverbs, wisdom can get cranky when no one listens to her, and even sound like an 8th century prophet predicting dire consequences to the people that are inattentive. Yet Lady Wisdom ultimately delights in humankind, Proverbs says. Wisdom sees our human potential and possibilities. Wisdom has a wider view than any certain generation's difficulties and struggles, right? Because she's been there since the very beginning of all this enterprise. Human beings have been wrestling with many of these things for a long time. And wisdom tells us the answers are with me, with the Spirit of God bringing wisdom and truth, knowledge and love, even delight, to every situation. To answer the call of Lady Wisdom is to open oneself to seeing these possibilities and choosing to act upon them. I like the way Paul puts it in Romans in 5:5 that we read this morning. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. Maybe this aspect of wisdom, this this delight in humankind, this love of humanity, gives us a clue on how to share wisdom with our younger generations. If we share wisdom, knowledge, and truth we have received with a sense of delight and affirmation for the potential and the personhood of the younger people, maybe it will be better received. If we're willing to listen as well as advise. My older friend who told me about doing one thing a day was one of my wise elders. Her name was Eileen McKinley. She lived to be 101. And when I was going through some of my pictures from Myrtle Creek and Canyonville days, I found one of her with us on a confirmation retreat when she was about 90. Now, she had been a dancer, so she, you know, was in pretty good physical condition. But she accompanied those youth and even slept on the floor at Sunnyside Church a couple nights. She accompanied them, and her love and her inspiration and her enthusiasm was an inspiration for us all. She didn't pretend to be perfect or to have all the answers. She simply delighted in life and those youth. When we answer the call of Lady Wisdom, we find ourselves with her. We may find ourselves with her in the public square. And she will give us the courage and the wisdom we need there. We may be challenged to change our priorities, to take time to search out knowledge and truth. And finally, Lady Wisdom will give us the ability to delight in humankind because we can see a broader and deeper view, a view informed by the grace and love of God. Or maybe like Hagar said to his son, we may also take the time and attention to look closely through the eyes of grace, to look closely at each person we meet and find the goodness potential in everyone. Amen. From the mouths of the 5-6-year-old.
Tell me thy secret.